The night sky is a unique area of nature that is fun to explore, and we're going to learn about a very intriguing project known as the Kepler Project. And we're with Ruth Kraft, and you're the director of the planetarium at Kennedy School, right?
Correct.
Wonderful. And so that's where we are. And this is, of course, a facility that is in the school that school children use all the time. And you're here
all fourth, fifth, and sixth graders from South Bend schools come through here.
That's so awesome.
And also the students from Kennedy come.
Come. Great. All right. So tell us a little bit about the Kepler Project and what it is.
Okay. The Kepler Project is a space telescope that has been sent up, was sent up a year ago this past March, to stare at 100,000 stars, 100,000 specific stars that are like our sun, looking for planets that are going around those stars, planets, hopefully, to find planets like our Earth. Now, it'll find many others, but some that are about the same size as the Earth. And about the same distance from their star as our Earth is from the sun.
Wow.
So in other words, places where perhaps there could be life.
Okay, so that's pretty exciting. So that makes this one, this project, very specific, but also very unique, unlike some other, you know, telescopes that are up there. How long is the project going to last?
It will be up there working this project for 4 years.
4 years, okay.
4 years. Now, I suppose they might extend that, but 4 years was the plan.
Was kind of the original plan. Okay. Now, you've got a little demo here about how it works because, you know, it's looking at stars, as you said, and it's looking for planets. So can you tell us here what how this demonstration works?
Well, this light bulb will be the sun, or the star, I should say.
A star.
A star, any star.
Okay.
One of the stars it's staring at. This is the Kepler, actually.
Okay.
Or in this demo, it works as the Kepler.
Right.
And there are planets that go around that star.
Okay.
And what the Kepler does then, it works as this light sensor. This is a light sensor, actually.
Okay.
It measures the dip in the intensity of the light as the planet goes in front of the star. And it can, it'll make a graph of that information, and they can tell how big the planet is, how fast it's going around the star, how frequently it goes around the star, and it, well, it keeps that kind of records for 4 years.
Wow. Okay. Now, as I watch those little planets going around, I'm assuming it can only sense orbiting objects that are in that same plane, right? So if something is orbiting at
If it's orbiting, for instance, like this, it would never pick that up.
Okay.
So they have a mathematical formula for how, you know, how many, probably what would be the percentage of planets that they'd be finding around those stars.
Okay.
And some will, their orbit plane will be different.
Now, as the Kepler is orbiting, it's, you know, where in the universe is it orbiting and where is it kind of looking?
Okay, it is orbiting the sun. It's trailing the Earth, actually.
Okay.
It's behind the Earth. It is focusing on one spot. It's between the stars Deneb and Vega, which are visible in the summertime.
Yes, they
are. And it's looking between those stars at 100,000 specific stars. And it keeps itself oriented in that direction.
So if we take the kind of lights down in the planetarium and we turn this on, we'll get some data that's generated that we can actually see on a graph, right?
Certainly.
Okay. Well, how about if we do that? Because I'd like to see what the output looks like.
I'll turn off the lights.
Okay.
Well, let's turn on our
sun. Oh, there you go. Okay.
And would you like to make the planets go around?
Yeah. Okay.
This crank is under here.
Oh, okay. Got it.
Okay. It doesn't really matter which direction.
Okay.
And you want to go slowly because the sensor, and you're going to at a good speed, the sensor won't pick up something that's going around very fast. I mean, it can miss things if they go by too quickly.
All right.
But this will generate, this generates a good graph, as you can see.
Now tell me, you know, interpret this graph for me. I see spikes, they're repeating. So as that data comes in from Kepler, it's showing that something is going around.
It's showing that something is going around. It's showing that there, well, you can see two different lengths of spikes.
Short ones and long ones,
Short ones and long ones. Which one do you suppose would be blocking less light?
I'm guessing the small one, right?
Okay. So it's going to make a short spike.
Uh-huh.
And the big one is going to make a longer spike.
Okay.
It also tells, though, how frequently those planets are going around their star. In other words, how far they are. The ones that are farther away will take longer to get around.
To repeat.
For one thing, they're going more slowly, but for another thing, they've got farther to go. They're on the outside lane.
Sure. Okay.
And so the big spikes are much farther apart than the short spikes.
Right. Okay. All right. Now, is this like data and graphs like this? Can anybody take a look at it? Is it only limited to professional astronomers, or can amateur astronomers look too?
They make periodic reports, and I'm quite certain you can see the graphs on the internet. JPL, or the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, handles this particular project for NASA.
Wow.
So JPL, NASA, they have a special site called Planet Quest.
Ah, okay.
That is all about Kepler and other
projects
that look for planets.
Okay. And we'll have that information on the WNIT Outdoor Elements website so folks can link to it and find out more about it, which is kind of cool to actually see data that something that's, you know, shooting way out there is pulling in, which is great. If people want more information about the Kennedy Planetarium and some of the programs and projects you do here, how would they do that? And what kinds of stuff do you do?
Well, the first question, how would they find it more? Actually, if they call the school number, Kennedy number, Kennedy Academy and South Bend Schools, that would give them contact with me. And then as far as what I do, I do programs on request for evening programs for not-for-profit organizations such as scouts, church groups, homeschool groups, anybody that, an organization that would like a program.
Great.
And I'll tailor it to their what they want.
And of course, since it's a planetarium, you can project the night sky and talk about constellations and all of that, right?
Exactly.
Here. Yeah, that's great. Well, Ruth, thanks, because the idea of the Kepler telescope is really intriguing, that it's searching for someplace that could be inhabitable, and it's going to be really exciting to see the information that comes back.
Sure.
That's going to be fun.
Yes,
thanks.
I agree with you.
Don't forget to check out the Outdoor Elements website for, I can't remember.
And you can just look at me and you don't have to worry about
it. Okay, great.
Holy cow.
Yeah.
Let's get this done.
Yep. And we're with Tim Cordell, and you're the interpretive naturalist here.
I am. Good to be with you again.
Okay, so we won't use that part, but that just occurred to me. It's like, who picked that part of the universe? Well, I hope you enjoyed our far-out look at telescopes and more. Check out the Outdoor Elements website. We've got a great downloadable plan to make your own planisphere. And remember, you can find your own outdoor elements when you visit area parks and nature centers. We'll see you next time.
Outdoor Elements is presented in partnership with the St. Joseph County Parks Department, regional parks with natural fun, St. Patrick's County Park, Ferretti Boggo Creek County Park, Bendix Woods County Park, and the Spicer Lake Nature Preserve. Outdoor Elements is made possible in part by viewers like you. Thank you.